come, O Lord our God.
Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, Martyrs, and Faithful, God, have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant us, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We ask you, Lord, that through this holy liturgy we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace with people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, you have blessed each of us with the gift of a Christian family, that through our family life we may learn to love and care for each other. Open our eyes to recognize in all people the bonds of our universal kingship under the one fatherhood of God. May we unselfishly serve them who with us have been made co-heirs with Christ. We ask you through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Feast Day Mass is taken from the Epistle to the Ephesians. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for that is what is expected of you. Honor your father and your mother is the first commandment to carry a promise with it, that it may go well for you and that you may have a long life on earth. Fathers, do not anger your children. Bring them up with the training and instruction befitting the Lord. Slaves, obey your human masters with the reverence, the awe, the sincerity that you owe Christ. Do not render service for appearance to only please men, but do God's will with your whole heart as slaves of Christ. Give your service willingly. Do it for the Lord rather than for men. You know that each one, whether slave or free, will be repaid by the Lord for whatever good he does. Masters, act in a similar way towards your slaves. Stop threatening them. Remember that you and they have a master in heaven and plays no favorites. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you, that you may have a long life on earth. Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Observe, my child, your father's bidding, and reject not your mother's teaching. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. You cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. And when Jesus was 12 years old, they went up according to festival custom. And after they had completed its days, as they were returning home, the boy Jesus remained behind in Jerusalem. But his parents did not know of this. Thinking that he was in the caravan, they journeyed for a day and looked for him among their relatives and acquaintances. But not finding him, they returned to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were astounded at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been looking for you with great anxiety." And Jesus said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" But they did not understand what he had said to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and was obedient unto them. And his mother kept all of these things in her heart. And Jesus advanced in wisdom and age and favor, both before God and neighbor. This is the gospel of the Lord. Living like Jesus would have us live. We've all heard horror stories of about what some people have had to endure within their families, in their abusive families. And this is the main reason why our church grants permission for remarriage. Now, marriage is entered into as a sacred sacrament. And when it is entered into, we hope and we pray that it lasts until death do us part. But our church will not force people to stay together at any and all costs and forbid them to remarry again. The sanctity of marriage does not grant sanction for any kind of abuse and misery for a lifetime, whether it be of a spouse or of a child. The Christian family is based on love because Jesus Christ based everything on love. And if there is no love in the family, then that marriage is almost just a shadow. It's just a mist. It just disappears. Now, I was reading the other day about a robotics startup company out in Boston, and they're working on a robot that turns and actually faces the person that it is talking to. This is supposed to simulate a more human-like experience. And they advertise the robot as being able to help with video conferences, it can help with people playing all those different games, and all of that made sense to me. But then it added that the robot can also read bedtime stories to your child. And there's just something wrong about that. Bedtime stories to your child. That's not when you teach a kid how to read and write and all that kind of stuff. Bedtime stories are those little quiet gifts of moments at the end of a day when a family can come together, parent and a little child, and maybe they can finally spend a little bit of time together because you know how busy your families are. And if that is something that we have to create software for, then I feel sorry for those families that don't even want to spend that little bit at the end of the day together and want a robot to do it instead. The robot can mimic human interactions, but it can't replace them. Christian family values are not about even wanting to try. But if they're dropping all kinds of money into developing this kind of robot, this kind of software, there's got to be a need for it, there's got to be a desire for it, and I just feel bad for those families. I feel especially bad for those little children. This feast day was born in 1914. World War I, as I said, was already raging. It began on July 28th of that year. The war involved 70 million combatants, 16 million people were killed, and almost half of them were civilians. There was trench warfare. There was the machine gun. There was poison gas. And this was such a horrible spectacle that when it was all over in 1918, it was called the War to End All Wars. No one could imagine ever doing this again. And when our delegates met in Synod in Chicago, I would bet that everyone there had close relatives in some battlefront country. And 1914 was a long time ago. We need to remind ourselves that communication was at best a letter going on a boat across the Atlantic, then being carried across a war-torn continent, and then having to do the whole thing in reverse. During war, people could not know about the fate of their loved ones. You know, when my daughters go out, you know, they got the cell phones, and you want to know if they're a little bit late, you call them up, and immediately you find out, okay, everything's okay, and that's kind of reassuring. But during war, where all these people were being killed, you could not know what was happening to your family. And that worry, that anxiety, it had to be in the minds of our Synod delegates, and that had to affect the creation of today's feast day. And also when they created this feast day, as they were thinking about their family members, they also had to be thinking about the large Christian family of all of God's people. How do we do these things to each other? You know, the people that we are willing to massacre by the millions in 1914, 100 years later now, they're our strongest allies in Europe. How do we hate with such vengeance a century ago, and those same people today we embrace as brothers and sisters? How can we become so savage and so cruel? How can we think of others as so unimportant? You know, I started off by saying that the New Testament doesn't have a lot to say about the family, and that Christian family values come by synthesizing the gospel that Jesus preached for everyone and boiling it down to a household size. But this means that the Christian family is only living out what the larger family of all of God's children should be doing day in and day out. Jesus was clear that there were no boundaries to his gospel. That's why the Christian family is our definition, not his, because he didn't set up a special, you know, love your brother, love your sister, love your mom and dad, because he just wanted everybody to love all the time. In the Sermon on the Mount, he says, if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you, says Jesus? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, says Jesus, again, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. Jesus is testing us. He's challenging us. He's tempting us to see bigger than we're used to. We appreciate the blessings of the Christian family, but can we see that we're all family, that for as different as we are, that we all share the same little blue dot of a planet, and if we're going to do so at any hope at all for peace and prosperity, then we're going to have to try to do it together. And this is also the message of the Christian family writ large. Jesus practiced the Christian family, or the religious life, in his family, and we're told he did it on an unusual basis. And so may that practice of our faith, on a usual basis within our families, inspire us so that ours may be homes of love, relationship, and faith. And may then our Christian families then inspire us to spread those virtues out into our shared world where they are so desperately needed. And for these things we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather today in the Feast of the Christian Family, we pray for all the families of our church and our communities. We pray, Lord, that you may be welcomed there and that they may be places of love and of faith. We also offer our prayers at this time for Eldemiro Santos, who is in the hospital. We pray for a speedy recovery. It's offered by Linda Pahalski. We pray in memory of Aunt Wanda Dushko and Cousin Geraldine Yaglinski. As offered by sister-in-law Ann Floyd, as offered by Shirley Yaglinski Floyd. We pray for the continued health of Brandon Poe, as offered by the Foster and Poe families. We also pray for the continued health of Richard Foster, as offered by the Foster and Poe families. We offer our prayers for health and well-being of Sister Florence Nemkovich, as offered by her sister, Shirley Yaglinski Floyd. We offer our prayers for Rosie, a co-worker who is being treated for breast cancer and will be undergoing surgery in the next few weeks, as offered by Linda Pahalski. And we continue to offer our prayers for those battling cancer. Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Skrosky. Randy Clemens by Grandmother Dottie Baronis. Carl Dickinson by Joe and Peg Kuschuk. Fathers Ray Draven, Jan Bielczyk, and Maurice Lazelle, as offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. 2-year-old Jack Sela is offered by Mariana Foster, and Frank Skrosky by his twin brother Don, and also the Gates and Kirkendall families. And lastly, Liz Bridgman, recently diagnosed with cancer and raising 3 young girls on her own, is offered by Cindy Benjamin. Are there any other prayers that you would like to offer from the congregation?
Yes.
I would like to thank God for the blessing of a new great niece, Piper Ray.
Piper Ray?
Yes.
Well, very nice. Congratulations for your great niece. Piper?
Piper Ray.
Piper Ray. Okay. Piper Ray. Are there any other prayers besides the new birth of Piper Ray? Okay. For all of these intentions, Lord, plus the private ones that we keep in the privacy of our thoughts at this time, we ask that you also bless each and every one of us here gathered, and also those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God.
maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and he came again. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, suffered death, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead. This kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge the baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grandchildren are the crown of old men and women, and the glory of children is their parentage. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust as to the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior.
Thank you.
sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Almighty Father, accept this offering from your whole Christian family. Bless all your children with an obedient spirit and a loving heart. May each home which nurtures them be an image of your kingdom, and the care of their parents a likeness of your love for all of us. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God. Forever and ever. Unite with you in one Christian family. Therefore, with the angels and archangels, with all the saints in the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. All present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of them. We are the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood. Just as they believed, professed, and united with you, through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world, and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice, as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world, as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment, when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread, and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, with the temple and messianic light, with the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all of those he had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. And after these and other words of the archpriest in prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son, our Lord, as well as the blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life. And to those who are in life's straight from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your Father alone, mercifully short their sufferings, we ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Forever.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence.
Thank you.
Deliver us, Lord, from all evils, past, present, and future. And by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with the blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days, supported by the help of your mercy. May we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbances. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. In Jesus Christ, bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant her peace and unity in your kingdom. You live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the grace that he has given me? I will take a chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy, enter into my heart, but I say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Body.
Christ. My child, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and abundant welfare, they will give you. The Lord be with you. Heavenly Father, as a family united in your word and in the Eucharist, we entrust to your loving care and correction the members of all of our Christian families, both near and far. Supply their needs, guide their steps, keep them safe in both body and soul, and may your peace rest upon us always. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Oh, the sacrifice is offered.
Praise be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most Holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came to be, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be was in him found life, light for the light of men. The light shines out in darkness, the darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. The Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.
Thank you, God.